Yeah, so good evening, everyone. Yeah, so good evening, everyone. I hope I am audible to you all. Yeah. So I think we can start now. Am I audible? Can anyone confirm?
Ma'am.
Yeah, okay, fine, fine. So this is week 8 of tutorials on fundamentals of electronic devices and materials. So like, and in last week you had mentioned to me that some of the equations from MOSFETs are missing from the formula sheet, right? So I had inquired with sir and he mentioned that what all is there in the formula sheet, only questions from those portion will come. So it probably means that from MOSFETs you will be getting logical or descriptive kind of questions. There won't be much of an equation based problems. That is what I came to know. So is that okay? Does that clear your doubt? Yeah, hello. Like, people had mentioned to me that in the formula sheet, equation for the potential and equation for inversion, like what happens during strong inversion and all those things were not there. So I had asked sir whether it is an important portion and there is any scope of including those equations, and he told that whatever is there in the formula sheet, if you have seen the formula sheet, it is already uploaded in the NPTEL portal. And have every one of you gone through the formula sheet that was uploaded? Have you gone through? Has anybody gone through the formula sheet? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah.
Madam, give me 5 minutes. I should be reaching home. I'm driving now.
Okay, fine,
So I'll
fine.
reach. And you were mentioning something about the formula sheet. What
Yeah,
was it?
like the thing is, in last class you mentioned, right, there are no equations on MOSFETs, like few equations on the line width of laser, MOSFET equation, those are missing. So I asked sir, and he mentioned that those like areas will not be having numerical problems. So whatever is there in the formula
Okay,
sheet,
got it.
only problems from that area will come. Yeah.
Sure.
And for
Thank
the
you.
rest of the people in the chat right now, have you gone through the formula sheet and have you seen the thing? Like three other people have also joined, right? Three or two, I guess. Dr. Helen, Sanjeet, and Sarla Shanti. Like three of you, have you gone through the formula sheet? No. Can you just check right now? Because in case you're planning to write the exam, it will be a problem later on. So it's better to get familiarized with the formula sheet before going to the exam. So can you just check right now? So let me see if I can log in from here. So if you go to NPTEL Swayam portal, there you have to log in. So go to your courses. So if you see here, like I think in week 8, yeah. If you go to week 8, final exam information sheet. This is the thing. So there is a page that says final exam information sheet, and the final exam will be in multiple choice. There will be 50 questions, and these questions will include things from your practice assignments, from your submission assignments, as well as from the problems that were discussed during class. And there are certain videos that say like practice problems on so and so topic, right? So those will also be included. And in this particular drive link, you'll have a sheet, and this sheet will also be supplied during the final exam. And whatever numerical problems you are getting, you will be able to solve based on the formulas in this sheet. So these are the things. Initially, we have a few constants like what is Hc, the Boltzmann's constant, then charge of an electron, mass of an electron, Avogadro's numbers, then permittivity of free space. And from week 1 till week 8, what all areas we have discussed, so those equations are included. So if you see from the initial sections from week 1 to say till week 6, most of the equations are included here. Say up till, if you see this DE part, DE, that is what, which length, let me check, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. After the 12th line, like almost all equations from all the portions are included here. But after that, only like 4 to 5 equations are there. So one of the students had pointed out that some equations from the MOS, like area, like MOSFETs and JFETs, from that area a few equations, and few equations from the laser part is missing. So I took this up with the professor who's in charge of the subject, and he mentioned that whatever equations are here in this page, only those whatever is required is given here. So we need to focus only on these things, and don't worry, there is no MOS part. Or even in the upcoming lessons, like in solar cell chapter, you have a lot of equations, but here only the equation for short, like open cyclic voltage, is given. So probably, if at all numerical crumbs from that region, you'll be able to solve using this equation. So that is the thing. So that is what was said to me. So I hope that it goes like that. But just in case, if you feel that a particular area is very important and some equations are missing from that part, just try to keep the basics of that equation in mind. Something like a proportionality, like so and so is inversely or directly proportional, or if something is exponentially proportional, just try to keep those things in mind. Other than that, whatever is needed for the examination is already here. So please go through the formula sheet very well before going to the exam, so that the examination hall is not the first time you see the sheet. And in this particular sheet also, there are a lot of letters, like what is E, what is K, B, T, N, A, and D, and be familiar with those things as well. Otherwise, you'll be having all the inputs in your question, but then you won't be able to substitute. So whenever you're solving for practice, try to solve along with this formula sheet. So is that clear to all of you? Is that clear? Yeah, 1% replied. What about
yeah, yeah, clear, clear.
Yeah. And I had asked like people who joined recently to go through whatever assignments we had discussed in the previous weeks. And in case you have any doubts, you can ask right now. Do you have any doubts from the previous week and the contents that we had been discussing so far? Any assignment question or anything like that, you can ask right now. Anything?
Can you explain me the working IV characteristics of solar cell?
Yeah, let us finish the like contents of today, and then if we'll see that part. Is that okay?
Okay, what is the contents for today?
This is like basic things on solar cells, I would say.
Okay.
Yeah. Other than that, I think
yeah, I'm asking solar cell only. Yeah, IV characteristics cell only asking.
Okay, like IV characteristics part. Okay, fine. Like basic thing I can explain. Other than that, and one more thing for the exam, from the examination point of view, like focus more on the initial chapters, I would say. And what, and if something comes from the whatever is from the later on contents, it will most probably be in a logic form or in a descriptive form. That is my expectation based on my conversation with sir. So like try to be very well versed at the initial part, like basic things like Fermi level, band gaps, then NP carriers, what happens in a Schottky and metal junction, and so and so, and those things. Yeah, so after finishing today's contents, we can see IV characteristics.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so I hope that's all. Yeah. So maybe we can start today's contents. So let me check. Yeah. So today we'll be discussing these photodetectors and solar cells and things from that. So first let me ask, so which is an equivalent circuit for a solar cell? What is the equivalent circuit for a solar cell? That is the question.
It is a PN junction plus a resistor.
Okay. In which bias?
Forward.
Okay. So can you just explain like how that works?
I wanted to know when I meant IV characteristics.
Okay. External load?
I wanted to know, yeah, external load is there.
Or resistor.
But there was, yeah, external load or?
External load or resistor, like external, correct. Like instead of using the word resistor, we usually use the word external load, and this correct. Thing is in forward bias.
I wanted to understand, it's a PN junction,
yeah,
but professor also mentions that whenever there is a load acting on it, it will act as a it will be in forward bias, right? Yeah. Whenever there is a load not acting, it is more of a only the photo current, whatever is there, that is there within the system.
Yeah, and the photon, whatever, like the forward bias actually opposes this photo current.
Correct, that's right. Yeah. my whole thought process in understanding is that this photo current is only going to the load, right?
So
professor mentions there are two types of current, that is ID and IPH, which is the photo. I was assuming that this photo current is what is being used by the load whenever
the
it
thing
shines.
Is if you keep a PN junction as it is and it is such that when you incident light on it, a current will keep flowing, but in order to extract this current into the external resistor, we need to apply something, right?
That is
what,
the load.
Yeah.
The same current, whatever photo current is generated, will go into this load, right? There is nothing more than that.
I'll just explain it, the whole thing. Like basically what you said is correct. Like we have a PN junction material. Let's say we'll draw something like, yeah. So basically you have something like this. So you have an N, a very small N region and a large P region. Anti-depletion will be such that there is some part into it and most of it lies in the P region, right?
Correct.
Yeah. And now if you are connecting the P region to what? Say, let us connect the, or like, can you tell me like what is the connection here, plus or minus? Like, will you connect the P to positive or negative?
P to positive and N to negative. Forward bias, right?
Yeah. So basically the holes get repelled to this side and holes will get repelled to this side and electron will get repelled to this side, right?
Correct. Injected.
Injected to this side, yeah. So basically what will be the potential across this depletion region? What will be the direction of field?
It will be in the opposite direction to the PN junction potential.
Yeah, so basically what happens is there is plus over here and minus over here, right? This is the direction of field, right?
Correct.
So what happens is when you incident a particular amount of light, let us call that light as H nu.
Correct.
And there will be electrons and holes generated in this depletion region.
Correct.
And because of this potential, what happens? Which side will the electrons go to and which side will the...
No, this potential is not, you're not injecting a current, right? It is more of a load getting connected.
No, here there is no load now. There is no load now.
Okay, there is no load now, then you are putting a current into the PN junction?
Yeah, like, I'm just connecting, like PN junction is there, I have connected it to two terminals, so there is a voltage across which I'm connecting it, and by keeping in this setup, I'm same thing, what I'm doing is I'm incidenting a particular amount of light. So many things get generated here. So because of this potential, like whatever is there, this plus and this minus, these things will get separated, right?
Sorry, come again. I didn't follow.
Wait, we'll draw again. So when you are incidenting a particular amount of light, what happens is that There will
Electron.
always be, there is already a p-n junction there. There is a depletion region. There are electrons and holes present there Yeah, already because
because of the
electrons
depletion
and holes,
region.
because no, depletion region means nothing is there. Depletion, in the depletion region, initially nothing is there.
Why not? Because there is an n-n-p junction, right? There
Yeah.
should be some depletion region.
Depletion region means what? The term itself means that there are no carriers present in that region, right? That's the basic part that we study in p-n junction.
Correct, I don't deny that. But
Yeah.
so what I'm asking is,
Yeah.
depletion region means there should be some change of, because there is a p-n junction, right? There is a
Yeah.
depletion region,
Yeah.
correct?
Yeah.
There is a p-n junction, there is a depletion region. So whenever there is a depletion region, there should be some holes and electrons present there. Because it's a depletion region, there will be some movement from the N side and the P side.
Yeah, some
Correct?
movement will be there, but what happens is they cross this region and they get absorbed in this part. So that finally at equilibrium, what happens, the depletion region will become vacant, nothing will be there. There will
Okay.
be movement, and at equilibrium, what happens is that they will all be inside either the P or the N side, and this entire depletion region will be free.
Okay.
Yeah, and
And
then
now you are
what will.
saying there is a light incident.
Yeah, now I am inserting some amount of light. So initially what was empty, that place, so these are solid materials, right? Like this is entirely P, this small region is N. So from that solid part, these electrons and holes get generated. They start, like because of this excitation from valence band to contention, like conduction band, electrons and holes will get created inside the depletion region.
Because of the incident light.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like what
Correct.
happens is when you incident light, if the light has sufficient amount of energy equal to the band gap of this particular material, what happens is that whatever is there in the valence band, they'll get excited to the conduction band. So in conduction band, electrons will be there, and in valence band, holes or these plus things will be there. So in this region, plus like holes and electrons get generated. Now, since it is connected to this plus and minus, and since the field exists across the depletion region, whatever is generated, they get separated. Like
Correct.
this, yeah, this is plus, so electrons will move towards this side and holes will move towards this side, right?
Correct.
So they keep moving, so and so they will start moving. And now what you do is, you will keep a load here. This is my load.
You have okay, correct. This is
And
your
then
load,
what
correct.
happens is they just come again and they recombine.
Okay, this is the current, correct?
Yeah.
Flowing through the load, correct?
Yes, yes.
So now if you write the equation, what is the total current in this whole circuit? It will be IPH, right? Only because the same current, whatever is generated to the photon, it is flowing through the load.
Load, yeah.
So there is only one current, right?
No, yeah.
But the equation which sir has mentioned,
so
it says two
basically, no,
currents.
like what I'm saying is, initially, if the external circuit is short circuit, means that if the load resistance is zero, then it is only due to IPH. Now when
Yeah,
the
one is the load is there.
yeah when the load is there, there comes the next part. So basically this is because IPH, what IPH means, it is due to the electrons going into the N side. Like electrons will go, like this is the N side, right? This is the P side. So these
Correct.
electrons are going into the N side, holes are going into the P side. And what happens
Correct.
during that? Due to the electric field.
Correct. There
Right,
is an
because of
electric
that
field.
motion, one
Same
current is
electric
there.
field
Yeah,
will
that is the
flow here. Yes.
IPH. Yeah. That is the IPH. But the forward bias current is due to the depletion, like diffusion current.
Yeah, this is what I didn't understand. What is the diffusion current here? What do you mean by diffusion?
Which is caused by the injection of these minority carriers. So, like what happens is, this is there, right? Plus is there.
Correct.
So, it part of it goes, like part of the plus goes into the external load, and then they become the minority carriers in the N side, right? Yeah, that is the injection of minority carriers. So if you see, like, if you have the textbook, right, can you go to page number 185?
So, one second. Yeah, let me get the textbook first. I have two more questions. Yeah, I'm there on 185.
Yeah, so on 185, if you see, solar cell IV characteristics, there it says, right? If the external circuit is a short circuit, that is if zero, then the current is only due to the generated electron hole pairs, and that is the photon current. But when there is an external load, then the equivalent circuit becomes such that V is equal to IR, the usual thing. Yeah, and this voltage opposes the built-in potential and reduces the barrier for carrier injection across the junction. And that is when it behaves like a P forward bias PN junction.
Yeah, but the current flowing through the load also, it acts as forward bias, I'm not denying. But the current flowing through the load also is the IPH only, right?
No, IPH is only when the external load resistance is zero. Like whatever is there only like because of light. We are not saying that this part is there. That part is not there for IPH. But when you are adding something like this, and another component gets added. Right.
Correct.
And voltage across this load V is equal to IR.
Correct.
And this voltage, whatever is there, it opposes this potential, whatever is there across this one.
Agreed.
And current due to this field is IPH, and current due to what do you call it? How do you denote it? I think ID.
ID.
Yeah, ID. Yeah. And current due to this part is ID. So total current will be IPH and ID, and since it is in opposite direction, it is minus IPH and plus ID.
Okay. My whole thought process is,
yeah,
when whatever the current is flowing in this load, right, V is equal to IR, the part of the current will be from this photo generated load, right? The IPH only will flow through there.
Yeah.
That was my, correct?
Part of it, yeah.
The current is generated there only, right? IPH is generated there, and that current is flowing through this resistance, and there is where there is a voltage. Maybe there is less current flowing there based on the resistance.
Yes.
That is leading to a voltage.
Yes.
But the current parameter is only one IPH. That was my assumption, because there is a light coming and same current is flowing through this load. There should be one current. Maybe it has two components.
Exactly. Yeah.
One current is flowing here, and one is the reverse bias current. The current flowing through that ID. There will be some reverse bias because of the forward junction. That is true. That is okay.
Yeah.
But I was feeling there is only one component, but I'm not aware of this ID. I'm not understanding that ID.
Okay.
Understanding right?
Yeah,
or there
it
is
seems
some,
right. I and don't if you know. Want, you can take a minute to like again read that and just conceptualize what you like are trying to understand.
Yeah, I did that couple of times yesterday. Okay. I was reading this only, I think, the whole day yesterday. So I could not get through that. Convinced. My conviction is not there. Okay. I can follow this, but I'm not getting that conviction to say that there are two components of current. There is a different current here and there is a different current there.
Okay.
I am not very convinced on this.
Actually, there was a page like PV. So there is this one page called PVE Education. PVE Education.
Okay.
So in that, if you go to let me check here, and I'll show here itself. Where is it? Yeah. Like this is something very useful for people wanting to understand solar cells and things like this. Education, See, this is the page, semiconductor materials, and like all of these things, whatever we just said, right? Solar cell operation, if you go there. Where is it? Yeah, solar cell. Yeah, in solar cell operation, you have light generated current. Yeah. So, first, what happens is that, and even you have a video part telling what happens. So, first, light is incident, and electron hole, like absorption of photon creates the electron hole pair. And what happens is that, ideally, the
There is a
minority
load.
carrier. So, what happens is it crosses the junction and becomes a majority carrier there. It goes through the load and just comes back here and becomes a
Correct,
majority.
correct.
And after passing, they meet up and completes the circuit. So that is what happens.
That is
So
the current, correct.
yeah, this is the light generated current part. Is that part clear?
Yeah, that is clear. I understood
Yeah.
this. Now it is clear. Now there is only one current. Now I'm not able to follow this equation. Minus IPH, I know. Professor is trying to say that there are different directions.
Okay. Let me check if something.
Here also the equation is IL is the incident light. I think
Okay.
that's what they are trying to say.
So this, I think this is your doubt. Like collection of light generated carriers by itself does not give rise to power generation. So a voltage must also be generated, right? So is that part your doubt?
Yes. I think he's tried to touch this. One second, go
Okay.
there. Little bit up, little bit
Yeah,
up.
yeah, yeah.
The collection of the light generated carriers does not by itself give rise to the power generation. In order to generate power, a voltage must be generated as well as a current. Voltage is generated in the solar cell by the process known as photovoltaic effect. The collection of carriers, the plane junction causes moment of okay, this is the same.
Yeah. However, if the light generated carriers are prevented from leaving the solar cell, then what happens? There is an increase in number of electrons in N-side of p-n junction and an increase in hole in p-type. So,
Correct.
and because of this separation, it creates an electric field which opposes the existing field at the junction.
Correct.
Yeah, and what happens is it reduces the net electric
Oh,
field.
no. Okay. Yeah, this is. Can you send me this page, please?
Yeah, it is PVE education. Just
PVE
PVE
education.
education.
Okay,
And it
got
is
it, got
very
it.
useful, not just for the course, but overall it's very useful if you want to have, and most of these
Yeah,
things
now I'm
have
on mobile. I'm
video.
joining to mobile only.
Yeah,
Okay,
this is the
you
page
can
name.
ping me this
P, yeah,
on
PVE
the education.
education.
Okay,
Yeah,
got it.
PV
Got it.
education, basically photovoltaics
Okay,
education. Yeah, and
perfect.
most
Thank you.
of it has schematics as well. Suppose if you see here, initially what happens? Zero voltage across the diode, no current flow. So then what happens is, yeah, no light, no V. So no light, no VOC. If VOC is there, light generates extra carriers and it goes. Is it like, are you getting, are you able to understand?
VOC, why VOC is
Open circuit
you need
voltage.
a yeah we then
Yeah,
now
we
it is
have,
VOC, right? No current flow.
yeah. And now we have connected a load. So what happens
Load.
is that, see that red dot, the whole part is running,
Correct, correct.
coming back, yeah.
Okay, yeah. And there needs to, where is the light incident?
Like in that part is this part, the second image.
Okay,
Yeah.
got it, got
Yeah,
it. Okay,
this
this.
yellow dot thing.
So when VOC is zero, there is no IOC. I is also zero, right?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, got it.
Now
Now
it's clear?
little bit clear. Yeah, clear. I think I can read this through and I can
Yeah.
understand. Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah. Okay, so we have a forward bias p-n junction part. So I hope at least some part of what a solar photovoltaic is clear to you. So
Yeah.
initially, no load, but when there is load, there is another current, and what happens is carriers get injected, they become minority carriers, so we keep holding them, we won't allow them to escape. And what happens is what field is generated there opposes the existing field. So that is why we have two current components. So you can just read through that page.
Yeah,
It'll
I'll
be
read
very,
through that.
yeah,
Okay,
it
I'll
will be
read
very
once
clear.
I read home, I'll read through.
Then, okay. So next is open circuit. This is a problem, and we have one equation in the formula sheet from the open circuit voltage part. So probably only that part will be asked, because I when I asked about that field in MOSFETs, it seems like there won't be questions. So similarly in solar cell as well, probably there will be questions only from open circuit voltage. So
okay, I could solve this question.
Okay, the open circuit voltage of a PN junction, that is VOC, is given as 0.45 volt when photocurrent IPH is 50 mA cm-2, that is per centimeter square. What is the open circuit voltage? We have to find out VOC when the photocurrent is increased to 500 mA per centimeter square. Temperature is 300 Kelvin and all other parameters are same. VOC in one condition is given, we have to find out VOC in another condition. Can you try?
We have to calculate IS not first. And
yeah.
Then yeah. You'll get an IS not based on the values given 0.45 and IPH 50 amperes, you will get IS naught, and based on that IS naught, you will take that and substitute in the VOC equation, and I think the answer was 0.51. I did solve this.
Okay, 0.51 is correct. Yeah. So firstly, we have to find out IS, so that is the reverse saturation current, right? And that came about to be some 1.4 into 10 power 9 ampere per centimeter square. So, like initial, the main equation that we use is VOC is equal to, can you tell me the equation? KBT by E ln.
Yeah, we will use first the equation.
IPH by ISO.
VOC is equal to KBT by E ln of IPH upon ISO.
So initially what we do is that VOC is given to us, IPH is also given to us. So from
first
that
we will use
constant, we get ISO.
Correct.
ISO we'll get, and then the same ISO we'll substitute, and again IPH changes, KBT, ln, everything is constant, and we'll get VOC. Like reverse, first, yeah. So is that clear to everyone? Is that clear? Yeah. Okay. So next is a statement question. Which of the following is true? Which is true? Regarding a photo detector, okay. Photo detector. So first is normally operated in forward bias. Sorry, reverse bias. So is this true or false?
True, true.
Why? Can you tell me?
Because in photo detector, it is in reverse bias, because when the light shines, there is a hole and an electron which will move in the opposite direction, and that is where the current is created.
Yeah.
That is where it is operated in reverse
bias. Okay, that statement is true. Next is the choice of semiconductor. Like suppose we are choosing a semiconductor. Choice of semiconductor is independent of lambda. Of lambda region that is to be detected. Is this true or false? That is, when we are choosing a semiconductor, should we consider the lambda region which we will be operating in it, or is it like any material would be fine?
No, lambda region is important.
Yeah, that is because whatever happens during this process, like h mu is coming, and only these electron hole pairs will be generated if, what is the condition? Can you tell me the condition? So if this is your SE, like
yeah, it is great. Yeah. It should be
like energy
greater than band gap.
H c by lambda should be
lambda.
Greater than Eg of our
semiconductor.
So this is the condition we should always keep in mind. If and only if energy of the incoming wavelength is greater than band gap of our material or semiconductor material, then only these electron hole pairs will be generated. Otherwise, it won't.
Correct.
Yeah. And can a pure semiconductor be used as a photodetector?
Pure semiconductor. Semiconductors.
Like say something like silicon. It's a semiconductor material. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. If we just connect metal electrodes to their end, we can use it as a photodetector, right?
Okay.
Yeah, so that is true. So next is a transistor cannot be used as a photodetector. So is this statement true or false?
Can be used, yeah, false.
Why would that be?
I think I read in the textbook somewhere there was a transistor which was a detector.
Okay.
I think there was a emitter base and
be like your BJT, right?
Yeah,
BJT. So BJT type of devices can be used as photodetectors. So I think from this type of like whatever is there in weak MOSFETs, JFETs and solar cells and lasers, from all those things, we try to be very clear with the logical part of it. So, and then one more thing, like one more question from previous year is, why are photodetectors cooled to liquid nitrogen temperatures, like photoconductors or photodetectors? Why are they cooled to liquid nitrogen temperatures? Why
because
that
thermal, because if there is a temperature, then thermal vibrations create some holes and electron pairs, and that might
increase the. That is known as thermal noise, right?
Thermal noise, yeah.
And one more thing is, if there is more of thermal noise, it affects the sensitivity of the device. Like if there is an uncontrollable amount of electron hole pairs that are being generated, and if like everything what happens in a solar cell, we should remember that these are happening in very, very small dimensions, right? If you see present day four solar cells, they will be as small as what? Something you can hold and something very much smaller than half of your finger maybe. That is the dimension of the solar cell that we are talking about. And if at all there are electron hole pairs being generated unnecessarily and we can't control the flow of it, the whole purpose gets destroyed. Suppose it was supposed to operate at a voltage of say 0.5 microamps and so that will get destroyed. That is why we say it affects the sensitivity. Like when we draw huge schematics, but that is not the case. Like present day
photodetectors are not solar cells, right? Photodetectors are something which are different.
Yeah, they are different, but all of these things, like they are like light related, right? Photoconductors, right. Photodetector, photovoltaics. It's just that what comes as the output is different. Yeah, like in some cases what we do is that using current we generate light, in our reverse case we give light to generate current or voltage.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you tell that website again? PV?
PV Education. For PV Education. PV
Education.
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
Like it's kind of, entire thing is kind of lengthy, but still all kinds of information, like basic things that we need to understand about photovoltaics, we'll get from there.
Okay.
Yeah, including schematics, yeah. So suppose we are considering a photodiode between A and B. What is the maximum wavelength of light? What is the maximum lambda for which excitation is due to B. So for example, Eg of B is given as 1.12 electron volt. Suppose you are making like a junction or a meteoric photodiode between some A and B. A is something like say BTS or whatever it is, and B is silicon or something like that. And what is the maximum lambda we are asking for which excitation is due to B alone? What is the maximum lambda value?
Yeah, you have to put that in the E is equal to hc by
yeah
lambda, and then instead put the calculate the lambda, and below that everything can be observed.
Yeah, and there was the shortcut for this, right? Eg is equal to, do you remember?
Eg is equal to
hc by lambda. Instead of substituting hc and calculating, converting, etc., if Eg is in electron volt, there is an easy way by which we can get the lambda value in nanometers. That is 1240 by lambda nanometer.
No, this I did not know. Okay.
Yeah.
Observer lambda nanometer. Okay. Okay.
Yeah. One this, is EV. One is
just
nanometer.
Multiplied HC and HC have multiplied. That's the value. Okay.
Yeah.
Lambda is in
just 1240. Okay. You can just remember the point. Only thing is that keep in mind, whatever is there is here in EV and whatever is there in nanometer. And suppose in the question they just ask to convert EG into joules, you have to just do it 1.6 into 10⁻¹.
Mm.
Yeah. That is there.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. So what, like, do you know what is the air mass number, AM value? Air.
A0, A1, A2, A3.
Yeah. What does that mean? And whenever we say solar cell, we say their efficiency at the particular air mass number. AM1, AM2, efficiency of so and so at AM1, at AM2, and so and so.
I think AM0 is incident, AM1 is 60 degrees, AM2 is 70 degrees, something like that, or there is only 1, 2, 3. I'm not sure if there is zero.
Yeah, there is AM0, but it is the solar spectrum outside Earth's atmosphere. AM1 is zero, and so on. So AM2 is 60. Yeah.
AM1 is zero, right?
Yeah.
Okay. AM1 is zero.
And AM2
is 60. And then it is 70, right?
Yeah.
M3 is 70.
And if I ask, for example, I'm saying something, which is why, like, is AM2 higher than or less than, like, intensity of solar radiation in terms of intensity?
AM0 is higher. AM1 is higher.
Solar radiation, what is it? Like, intensity of AM2 is greater than or equal to AM1. AM1
is greater.
Okay, so it is greater. So depending on this angle, the intensity, the amount of light that gets incident on the entire Earth and any device which we are using gets changed, right? So that is the air mass number. So using this, we'll calculate the efficiency at each time of the day.
Yeah.
So that is the air mass number. So then, yeah, and next question is the total region in a solar cell from which current is generated includes what all things? Total.
Come again?
Total region in a solar cell. Solar cell from which current is generated? From which current is generated? Is what all things? Like we said, in that initial part we said, right, so there is this p-n junction and you have the n material here, p material here, so your depletion width is something like this. This is because n is lightly doped, p is heavily doped, and this is the depletion region. We know that when light is incident, most of the electron hole pairs are generated like here, right?
Mm.
Yeah. But other than this, some extra length is also there. So, and because of
the NMP also.
Yeah, like they move around and they create the current part. So the total region in the solar cell from which current is generated includes what all? Is it this depletion width alone or there is something extra?
There is extra, right? LE and LH.
What are LE and LH?
length of the electrons in the n region and the p region.
Region, yeah. That is also known as minority diffusion length.
Diffusion length, yeah.
Yeah. And after like passing through the minority diffusion length, they get recombined and lost. That is the concept.
Mm.
Yeah, they won't contribute to what flows against, like against the load.
Correct.
Yeah. So that is the. Okay. So next is what is quantum efficiency of a photodetector?
Light incident
quantum
to the number of
holes
per electron.
Can it come again? What is quantum efficiency?
Light incident.
Okay.
Divided by number of
photons.
Holes per number of
carrier
generated. Yes. Carrier
generated. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, generated. So, and one more logical question that can come from here is, how do you increase the quantum efficiency of any material, any like photo sensitive material? What is the different ways by which you can increase the quantum efficiency? Can you think of it?
By
yeah, it has something to do with lambda, something to do with
lambda,
penetration
yeah.
depth, and can you tell me what those things are? Basically, quantum efficiency is like n mu is equal to IPH divided by E phi. That is the number of carriers generated per photon. This E phi is photons. This is the photon flux. Photon flux. It's like 1 by this part. Is that clear? It's not light incident by carrier generated. It is basically current that is carrier equivalent to carrier generated by light incident. Light incident means the equivalent photons that are generated. So QE we can write as carriers generated by light incident, which translate to carrier generated means IPH. Because of the carriers, there is current, and light incident means the photon flux or phi. Is that clear?
Yes.
Yeah. So what are the ways in which you can increase this?
You can increase the lambda region,
okay,
which can be.
And what is the name of this thing? High quantum efficiency, they're like one main part is there. So, yeah, like if we would say that it is by making width of the intrinsic region, width of the intrinsic region much greater than what is it penetration depth.
Okay.
Yeah. So and there is one relation between absorption coefficient and penetration depth, right? Like that also you can relate to it.
Yeah.
What they're inversely proportional, right? Absorption coefficient
yeah.
decides the penetration depth, and if there is a large absorption coefficient, it means that the penetration depth would be very low.
Right.
So alpha WD, this is should be greater than 1. This is the condition for improving the quantum efficiency. So alpha, it connects to penetration depth. These two things are inversely proportional. Greater the alpha, lower the penetration depth. So what we have to do is that whatever is this width of the intrinsic region should be much, much, much greater than the penetration depth. Is that clear?
Width of the, I am a little bit, can you explain? Come on. Alpha, UD should be greater than.
Like, which part?
Yeah, alpha WD come again should be greater than 1, right?
Very greater than 1, yeah.
Yeah, penetration depth should be greater than, well, you mentioned something.
Okay. So
last statement, can you repeat
alpha,
it?
So let me call it alpha is proportional to 1 by penetration depth, right?
Correct.
So alpha into WD should be greater than 1, which means that WD should be greater than 1 by alpha, or WD should be greater than penetration depth. Is it clear?
Yeah. Got it.
Is it clear for the others as well? Anybody? Like in, I feel in all the sessions only one person has been responding throughout, and that is who is rest. Yeah, and Sarla has also replied. Rest, nobody is replying. So is it clear? Yeah, yes, yeah, they are replying now. Yeah. And what do you know? What is WD, width of the intrinsic region? Hello? What is width of intrinsic region? WB. Can you tell me? Yeah. Anybody?
Formula?
Not formula. Logically, what is WB?
It's the depletion region, right?
Yeah, like where the carriers are generated. That is the main thing. Yeah. So, like suppose you have seen, suppose penetration depth means H nu is coming, and the depth, the length through which, length across which the light actually penetrates. Suppose if the penetration depth is this much, only from these region carriers will be generated. So if the penetration depth is this much across this entire region, carriers will be generated. So, if you want to increase efficiency, whatever width of, and this is your depletion region width, so this height should be greater than this height. Is that clear? So that maximum number of carriers are generated and they can be removed to the external circuit. Is that clear?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, clear.
Yeah. So, 1 minute, we connect my charger. And have you submitted all your assignments or are any assignments pending? Like anything for this week?
I had one question on the assignment number 8. I'm not able to answer that.
Okay. So, after we finish this, we can go through assignment 8. Is the submission date over?
No, not yet over.
And when is it?
Tomorrow, I think.
Okay, every Wednesday you have submissions, right?
20th Wednesday,
yeah. So other than that, what is there? Okay, something known as, one more thing that was explained is tandem solar cell.
Yeah.
What is a tandem solar cell?
Connected in PN junctions in tandem.
Yeah, and when you're connecting, suppose this is one PN junction, another PN junction, what is the relation between band gap and the way in which they are like arranged? So will smaller band gaps come in interior or exterior? So this is the interior, let us say this is the exterior, and this is from where the H nu is coming. So will I keep the one with higher band gap closer to the illuminating surface or not?
Yes, higher band gap. One second.
Yeah.
You need to keep higher EGs at the exterior.
Yeah.
That will consume shorter wavelengths.
Yeah.
So shorter wavelengths are at the exterior and higher wavelengths are
the interior. Yeah. So this EG lower. So tandem solar cell basically means that normal solar cell is only one PN junction device. But when you're stacking multiple dumps in an array, that is what is known as a tandem solar cell. And while arranging tandem solar cells, we'll be arranging them in such a way that the higher band gap PN junctions are towards the exterior and the lower ones, it comes in a descending order if you see the EG values. And the reason is that so higher energy radiations or the shorter wavelength will be absorbed by the outer cells, and the longer ones will be allowed to, like it'll move across the cell and get absorbed by the internal ones. Is that clear? And it also helps us in utilizing a much more part of the spectrum. Yeah. Is that clear? Those are tandem solar cells.
So shorter wavelengths at the exterior, right?
Yeah. Shorter wavelengths will get absorbed at exterior, longer ones will go away.
Longer wavelengths at the interior.
Okay. Yeah. If you're using a single material, what happens is that after the penetration depth, everything gets lost, right? Yeah, so if we are keeping another material capable of absorbing the longer ones, just below the first p-n junction, all of that wavelength will get added up to your whatever output we are getting.
Correct.
Yeah, so that is tandem solar cell. Yeah, so now we can discuss like what all doubts we have in the assignment part.
I have only one. Question number 3. Okay. In the assignment 8.
So can we go through the questions one by one so that it's kind of clear to all of you? Like since exams are approaching, we can just revise and go one by one. First question is, a photo detector is commonly operated under dash. Like I think in today's session also it was explained, right? Reverse bias. Yeah. And the reason is that whatever generated like electron hole pairs, they get separated and current can be measured. So that is thing. And next is, which of the following transitions are used in a photo detector? Like what are they? Like 3 are there in total. So what are they?
Interband, intraband, and barrier height transitions.
Yeah. Is that true?
Yeah.
Can you check for once more? Intraband, is it allowed or not?
Interband, intraband, and barrier height transitions.
Yeah, barrier height is correct. Interband is correct. So third one, is it intraband or barrier to band to impurity transitions? Like if something is moving in the across the same band, does that help in a photo detector? Because is there an excitation happening to a higher energy level with the generation of electrons and holes in that case? In case of intraband, I must say.
Okay. If you go to page 177.
Yeah, 177. Okay.
Band to band. Impurity transitions.
Okay.
Impurity to band.
Excitation fan. They are asking photo detector. This is whatever you are saying is photo conductor.
Photo detector also.
Yeah. And detector means what?
So you say that intraband is not there and band to impurity transitions is?
Yeah, band to impurity is anyway there, right? Because there will be suppose this is your valence band and conduction band, and there will be these trap states. Like trap states is due to impurities, right? So instead of just going to this part, even going to this part will also help in generating electron hole pairs, right?
Correct.
Yeah, so band to impurities anyway there. That is true. Yeah, the interband is also there. Interband means moving from here to here.
Conduction band to valence band.
Yeah,
correct.
And the barrier height transition is also there. Interband means moving across these things.
Intraband means what?
Intra means across the same band.
Okay, that will not lead.
That will not lead. Yeah. So next is, which of the following statement is not applicable to metal semiconductor junction used as a photo detector?
And this I could not answer.
Okay. So the question is, which of the following statement is not applicable to a metal semiconductor junction used as a photo detector? One is, metal semiconductor junction is ohmic type. Is it ohmic type or Schottky type?
Schottky type is what I believe.
Yeah. So then photons of energy greater than band gap can be observed with photo detector. So that is true. it is applicable. Photons of energy greater than Schottky by the way, less than semiconductor can be answered. That is also true. Then photo detector operated in reverse ways. B, C, and D are true, right? They are applicable.
Okay, I didn't went by an elimination method here. Okay, I knew that bottom three are correct. I was not sure of the first one.
Okay.
So what is that? So there are no metal semiconductor ohmic type photo detectors. That's what is the conclusion?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Because it has depletion region that can be used for carrier generation, right?
Mm.
Yeah. Ohmic, but if you are using ohmic type, they'll have an accumulation region instead, right? If you remember.
Mm-hmm.
So only if in an accumulation region there is no scope of generating and then separating, right? If you have a depletion region, the material is starting in that state and you incident light, you create more electron hole pairs, then separate and then use them in the like photo detector part. But
yeah,
if
I have
all
to go through this, revise this ohmic and Schottky.
Okay,
you know,
but in an accumulation region thing is that if you're joining the metal and semiconductor, already there is flow of these carriers and they are getting accumulated at the junction.
Mm.
Right.
Correct.
So in photo detector, there has to be a role of light. Like when light is incident, electron hole pairs has to be generated.
Mm.
In an accumulation region already, because there is flow and they're just waiting. Suppose for let me draw. In an accumulation region, what happens if this is your metal SC junction? Already lot of carriers here are waiting here. So when you incident much etch neo, there is no much scope of creating more and then separating them, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you have a junction such that this area is vacant, like all of this material is waiting so that when etch neo is incident, it can generate electron hole pairs. That is why we use Schottky instead of ohmic.
In Schottky, it is function of the metal is less than the work function of the semiconductor, right?
Yeah.
In ohmic, it is the work function of the metal is more than the work function of the
semiconductor,
correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So then,
good.
Yeah, two identical semiconductor HOMO junctions are used to make a detector and an LDD. In which case, the depletion width of the semiconductor under operation be lower. What was your answer?
In which case depletion width was LED.
LED, yeah.
Because it is in forward bias.
Yeah.
Rest all is in reverse bias.
Reverse bias. Okay. Any other question? The mechanism by which Schottky junction photo detector absorbs light.
Internal
photo emission. Yeah. Which excitants are primarily created in a pin photodiode?
I.
Yeah. Which of the following is a fair interpretation of quantum efficiency?
First one.
A pure solar cell is replaced by silicon germanium lower band gap. Assuming open levels all are similar, following statements are true. So open circuit voltage for silicon is higher than SiGe. Then have you attempted this one?
Yeah, I have. The pure, let me read it again. I said 2 and D, B and D.
B and D. Okay, intrinsic carrier concentration is lower. Efficiency is higher for silicon and SiGe. Reverse saturation current in Si. Like, one more option is correct.
One second, let me read through again.
Yeah.
Why is reverse saturation current of silicon higher than silicon germanium?
No, I didn't say C was correct. Either A or C is correct. One of them is correct.
Yeah, both of them. I don't understand. If you can help me.
So, if you see, we know that VOC is equal to KBT by E ln ITH by ISO. Right.
That's not.
Mm-hmm. So from this VOC, if this part goes up, what happens? It will reduce. So it is proportional to 1 by ISO. Is that correct?
Mm.
So and ISO saturation current, if you remembered was dependent on ni. From that equation, ISO is equal to ni square e, it is there, dE by ni, and so and so and so.
Correct.
So this is proportional. So if a material has a higher band gap, then its ni will reduce.
Correct.
Ni reduces means that ISO reduces. ISO reducing means that VOC will increase.
So it is then third is also correct, right?
A is also correct.
Third is also correct.
Yeah, reverse saturation for
silicon is higher than silicon
band gap. Whichever has lower, higher, silicon has higher band gap, right? Then it has lower
band gap means
lower SO.
Yeah. Correct. Third,
so
first one is
A,
correct.
B and D will be correct. Yeah, so this equation, if you see
B and D and A, B and D.
A, B and D will be correct.
Okay.
Yeah. So only thing is EG is higher, means that NI is lower.
Correct.
Then it would mean ISO is lower. Ni is lower means that ISO is lower from here. And that would mean that VOC will be higher. So all these relations we can say. EG proportional to VOC. Then EG proportional to 1 by Ni. Then EG proportional to 1 by ISO. All these things will work. These three conditions will work. Greater the band gap, greater the VOC, greater the band gap, lower the intrinsic carrier concentration, and lower the saturation current. Yeah, so that is question 8. Now, question 9.
Question 9 is done, right? We did 9.
Consider a PN junction solar cell. Which of the Fallon parameters will be changed, either increased or decreased? The photocurrent is changed. So we have to find out what all things IPH depends on.
A, B and D.
Okay, A will change obviously because VOC has IPH by ISO. Then you have ISE is minus IPH, right? Short circuit current is basically minus IPH.
Yeah, correct. So that will also change because of the radiation
change. Whenever IPH changes, we'll say short circuit thing will also change. So A and B, okay, then?
D is reverse saturation current is a constant.
Okay. And diffusion coefficient?
So diffusion coefficient will also change, right? Because of the...
Is it? Diffusion coefficient, what does it depend on? D is equal to? KT mu by E, right?
Okay.
Yeah, so it depends only on mobility and carrier life. So it doesn't depend on the
photon.
So only photo. A and B will be there.
Okay, yeah, correct.
Yeah, and what about 10?
10 is BCA, that is A.
10 is BCA, okay.
11th is D.
11th, let me check, answer is D, 0.5, and we have solved that one. And then what is the primary purpose of zigzag-shaped surface of a pearl solar cell?
Increase in wavelength region of the light absorbed by the cell.
Okay, is it, that is actually because of a tandem solar cell, right? Increase in wavelength region of light.
Okay. Zigzag also, pearl also the same, right?
Pearl, the zigzag kind of features has one important function. Like in any kind of solar cell, giving these protrusions has one main thing.
Does it see?
Yes, exactly.
But here it is minimizes the reflection of the sunlight
away from
the
cell. What happens is that initially light comes here. Suppose light comes here, falls on it. It goes to here, it again goes to here, come back. That multiple reflections will take place, right?
Correct.
And eventually, after multiple reflection, more of the sunlight goes inside compared to what goes outside.
So, away from the cell, how it is?
minimizes away from the cell.
Maximizes the reflection, no?
Maximizes into the cell. Maximizes into the cell.
Minimizes
away from the cell, which is equivalent to minimizes away from the cell.
I didn't understand the statement actually.
So basically, you have H nu coming.
Correct.
And if it is this much, some part of it goes inside, some part of it is lost. Okay. But if you have something like this on the surface.
Okay, got it.
Like it, what happens in a prism, like we have this total internal reflection kind of thing, right? Like instead of being lost, then one more thing we have to remember is surface area increases. Suppose you have this and this, both of them are of length L. So, and this is A, this is B. And in the same length L, if you are putting some features on top, the surface area of B will be greater than that of A.
Correct.
Right. So same way, what happens is, and these light get incident, and they'll, because of this proportion, they'll collide with one beam goes here, comes back here, it undergoes multiple reflection, and eventually what goes inside gets amplified. Loss is reduced. Yeah. So that is what happens in a pearl.
Yeah.
So, and next is, which of the following does not change with dimension of the solar cell?
B.
Is it? Reverse saturation has something to do with the depletion width, right?
Correct.
Yeah. So one thing that doesn't depend on the depletion width or any sort of dimension is
Power output of the cell also is dependent on the dimension.
Reverse saturation.
Open circuit voltage.
Yes, open circuit voltage. Open circuit voltage only depends on what all things, reverse saturation current and IPH, right? Like, this is a tricky question because indirectly even VOC depends.
Yeah.
But when asked in options, the thing is, only thing that does not change directly with the dimension is VOC. Because VOC is like depends on IPH by ISO. But IPH and ISO independently, they would depend on the dimension, right? But once this is fixed, VOC has nothing to do with dimension.
Okay.
Yeah. So next.
Yeah, 15th, I could not.
Okay, 15th is, look at the graph of solar spectrum's power as a function of light. Which of the following could cause difference in the spectrum at the top of atmosphere and sea level? The dips in spectrum at sea level at low wavelength correspond to absorption of sunlight by ozone layer. Dips in spectrum at low energies caused by water vapor, carbon dioxide. Dips in spectrum at high level. Okay. So basically, you have the solar spectrum on the top of the atmosphere and sea level. Which is top of atmosphere? Okay. This part and that part. The difference is that. What are these yellow and red? Can you just tell me? Okay. So what do they want from this? Look at the graph as a function of wavelength. Which of the following could cause difference? Okay. Sunlight direction. Okay, fine. Overall, they have the spectral radiance and wavelength that is being absorbed. So first one is dip in spectrum at low wavelengths correspond to absorption by ozone gas. Initially true, yes. At sea level true.
Correct.
Yeah. Then B, dips in spectrum at sea level at low energies. Lower energy would mean higher wavelength. No, higher. Lower energy would mean HC by lambda. Higher wavelength.
Lower energy, higher wavelength.
Higher wavelength. Dips in
spectrum. I didn't understand this cop. I don't know. I marked all of them correct.
Okay, only actually like ozone gas part is not there. That is true. Dips in spectrum at sea level, high wavelength, it's not affecting. The dips in spectrum at high energy by water vapor, carbon dioxide and other. That part is also not there. So basically you would have to compare, yeah. So in this part, what do you like? It's more of like something to Google and find out. energy difference between what is the incoming energy and what is the energy that is absorbed by this ozone, O3.
The ozone also absorbs some light, right? Yeah. Before it reaches
But whether it is lower or higher, you will have to find out from the value.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's like a Google kind of general knowledge kind of thing. So O3, CO2, CH4, and one more was there, right? Yeah, whether it is higher or lower, you will have to compare with solar radiation. What are the energies absorbed by these three things? You have to find it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that is all.
Okay.
Yeah. So next class, I think I have opted for 21, but so far Neil has not come, right?
21 is what for?
A revision class.
For all the revision. Okay, good. That will help. Yeah.
And one more thing is by 21, please to try to revise. You have exam on 24th, right? Yeah.
I should get time. That's it.
And like as much as possible, try to like keep all your doubts ready. On 21st.
7 and 8 is done.
Yeah. So
overall, I think revision today.
Yeah. Yes. So all of the whatever syllabus part is there, we have completed today. So by 21st, keep all your doubts ready, so that the entire two hours, if you don't have any doubts, I'll just do a practice problems. I won't give any hints. I'll just display the question, and you will have to solve by yourself. That is one thing we'll be doing. And
what time it is Thursday?
7 to 9. I've opted for 7 to 9 still. Yeah. And if you have doubts, keep. So 1 hour we'll do this practice part, and 1 hour we'll do for doubt clearing. If there is no much of doubts with you people, we'll do practice for the entire 2 hours.
Okay. Let's see if I should revise by then. If I'm successful,
and be
then.
Familiar with the virtual calculator as well as the formula sheet.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think whatever sessions I have been taking in these past few weeks were useful to you guys. So in your feedback forms, please do let me know if there is things that can include or improve or anything. And one more thing I wish from your side is, if you see that any of your friends are joining for NPTEL courses, please do ask them to join these live sessions. Yeah, like we have some many people enrolled, but only very few attend these live sessions, right? So
maybe student community might know well.
Well, better, that is true. So that is one thing.
I am doing it of interest. I just wanted to learn. What is the next course? Anything in line similar to this?
No, only two courses are there, at least from this part. One is fabrication and one is this materials.
Okay, anything coming for newly? Because semiconductor as a subject is going to increase right now because of
true. But thank you. Yeah, I think only these two courses are there from the faculty that I am working under is like this particular course is from Dr. Parshuraman sir. He's taking only these two courses in NPTEL. Yeah.
Okay.
So far in the forms that like what happens to us is now that we have completed these 8 weeks, we'll wait till August. Again, we'll get an intimation that whether we are interested to become TA for any of the courses. So at that time, again, a list will be floated what all is available in the upcoming.
Fine, I'm asking about if any similar courses for semiconductors.
No, I have not come across. Yeah, there might be things on SSDs, but that will be...
What is SSD?
Solid state devices, but that will be too much of material related things. I don't know if it will help you in understanding basics of some like semiconductor materials, but...
More on lattice and all those
things. Exactly. Lattice defects, how it affects the overall working, those things. Solid state devices. Like it's more of...
Probably I'll go through that course at least.
There might be courses on solid state devices. But the thing is, content-wise, it won't be that consolidated. It's a very huge subject. One person from here has completed SSP part. So can you unmute and tell what are the course contents so that it might help the other person?
Who has completed?
I have Dr. Helen Marina Albert. She has.
Yes, ma'am. It is, as you said, material related course. Crystal structure.
Yeah.
So one can do this. Semiconductor means it's easy, ma'am.
Yeah.
Same thing.
Yeah.
Basic and related problem.
Okay. So, yeah, that would be like more of crystal structure, material defects.
Ma'am. And,
No, I have done that in my undergraduate.
All materials and related material problems.
Yeah.
Only about semiconductor, that covers some more material kind of.
It will help in understanding, but as a course, if you're only interested in semiconductor, it will be an extra load understanding all those crystal structure, this, that, and that.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Please keep your doubts, assignments, anything and everything related to the course that you want to clear before the exam. Please keep those ready for the next week, else we'll just go through problems, and without any hints, only using our formula sheet, you yourself have to solve those problems. That will be our exercise for the next class.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining. Thank you, guys.